Yeah, so I'm going to talk about the dollar hegemon, and this is not just a research paper, but it's a sort of it's a paper where I combine a number of results that are related to work that I have done, but also others have done in this area. I think there's been a lot of renewed interest in understanding the implications of the dominance of the dollar in a number of dimensions, and this paper is an attempt at sort of taking stock of where we are and maybe asking ourselves some research and policy questions going forward. So the short of it is, you know, shouldn't come as no surprise for people who have been following the empirical macro international macro literature for the last 5-10 years is we live in a dollar world. Why do I mean by we live in a dollar world? Well, we know that global trade is invoiced in dollars, and I'll come back and I'll document each of these statements here in a little while. We know that the dollar is very important for cross-border financial flows, for security issuances. It plays, again, a very dominant role there. We know that the dollar is very important, as we saw from the previous paper and others, when we think about monetary policy, and the decision to anchor one's currency to another currency often involves a dollar on the other side. And the corollary of that is we know the dollar is one of the dominant forms in which central banks are holding reserves. So along all the trade, financial, and monetary policy and reserve holding, along all these dimensions, we know that the dollar is currently very relevant. What is a little bit less well known, although people who have studied economic history have known this for quite some time, is that in fact there is a you know, along a number of these dimensions, that dominance of the dollar is stronger now than it ever was, and that's something that you may view with a little bit of surprise, or you may find you know, as a sort of a provocative statement. I'll try to document that a little bit. All right, so when we think about this dollar world, that's going to matter along a number of dimensions. The role of the dollar is going to be important for international trade. It undergirds, if you want, the expansion or the era of increased globalization, whether on the trade side or on the financial side, that we've witnessed and that is actually being challenged in recent years. But the role of the dollar has been very important there. It's very important when we want to think about coordination of macroeconomic policies, in particular monetary policies, the transmission of shocks from the center to the periphery matters, the coordination of monetary policies in the periphery vis-a-vis the center matters as well. And it matters when we want to think about the provision of international liquidity, which is one of the key functions of an international currency, is to provide international liquidity in times of global stress. And so these sort of all these dimensions I've described to you in the previous slide, they're going to shape and constrain the choices that policymakers around the world are facing. They may constrain also the choices that US policymakers are facing, but in very different ways. Okay, so the outline of the talk here is, as Francesco alluded to, is going to first take stock of where we are, sort of describe the emergence of the current dollar hegemon from the ashes of the Bretton Woods system that preceded it, and in which the dollar was also had a very special role to play. Then I'll spend some time on very sort of narrow implications for policymakers in terms of the transmission of monetary policy in open economies, in spillovers of monetary policy from the center to the periphery, or in constraints on the global system, if we think about one particular dimension of this, which is the provision of safe assets. And then I'll speculate a little bit and make statements that are very much forward-looking, but certainly not have the same degree of scientific standard to them. Okay, so the dollar hegemon. I will start with a quote here from Charles Kindleberger. And Kindleberger, this quote is coming from a book he wrote in an article he wrote in 1981, in which he's sort of looking back and taking stock of a number of things that have happened and that he has spent his career studying, his academic career studying, and his policy career contributing to. And he writes, I argue that the world economy, for the world economy to be stable, it needs a stabilizer. some country that would undertake to provide a market for distressed goods, a steady, if not countercyclical, flow of capital, and a rediscount mechanism for providing liquidity when the monetary system is frozen in panic. And so here already outlines sort of the three important functions of sort of the center currency, or the, he never used the word hegemon, but then it was later on attributed to him by a specialist of international relations. And here he outlines sort of the functions of, the important functions of the hegemon, and one is about guaranteeing open trade and capital. The second one is about ensuring some form of coordination of economic policies, in particular monetary policy. And the third one is sort of a lender of last resort when the world enters a crisis. And he continues and writes, Britain, with frequent assistance from France, furnished coherence to the world economy along these lines during the 19th century and through the Belle Epoque. The United States did so from 1945, or perhaps 1936, maybe he had read Barry's subsequent work with Mark Flandreau, or 1968, or 1963, or 1971. So there is a little bit of uncertainty as to the start, there's a little bit of uncertainty as to the end, but clearly when he writes this in 1981, he views sort of the demise of the Bretton Woods system, which, depending how you date it, whether it's when gold-dollar convertibility is suspended, or it's whether it's when the Smithsonian Accord collapses and countries start floating against one another, and including against the dollar. So sometime between 68 and 73, the system ends, and that's when Kindleberger says, well, that's the beginning of the end of the dollar hegemony, or the U.S. hegemony on world affairs. Okay? But in fact, it did not happen. So even though a number of observers at the time shared Kindleberger's view, there was a dissenting view, and the best quote I could find of the dissenting view is something that Mundell writes in 1973, where he says, after Bretton Woods collapsed, the dollar assumed greater monetary importance than gold. So already by 1973, someone like Mundell is saying, no, the system didn't collapse. The dollar is actually even more important than before. And in fact, we have an increased dollar dominance for trade and invoicing and settlement, for securities, insurance, and holdings, and as an anchor, an intervention currency. I'm going to document all three things, and I'm going to come back and try to sort of maybe provide some ideas or suggestions as to why we may still have this dollar dominance nowadays, despite the fact that the Bretton Woods system collapsed because there was a run on the dollar. Okay, so we have the sort of original sin here, a run on the dollar, and yet the dollar emerges as the strongest or the hegemonic currency for the world economy. All right, so let me sort of go through a few facts that I'm sure many of you are familiar with, but I'm just going to compile them in one place here. So first, if you look at trade invoicing, here's one particular way in which I like to look at the trade invoicing data. This is the data that Gita Gopinath has used in or Jackson Hole piece on the international price system. This is showing you in blue, this is the share of imports that are invoiced in US dollars for a particular country. You have the list of countries at the bottom. And in red, this is the share of exports that are invoiced in US dollars for that same country. So if all of your imports and all of your exports are invoiced in dollars, this will top out at 200%. If none of your imports and exports are invoiced in dollars, you're going to be at zero and somewhere in between. I've ranked them by the total here. And what you see there is that there is a large number of countries in the world whose exports and imports are invoiced in dollars. Now, on the left, you're going to find a lot of Latin American countries, a lot of Asian countries as well. On the right, not surprisingly, perhaps, you're going to find many of either members of the European Union or Eurozone in particular, or other European countries that are sort of doing a lot of trade with the Eurozone. But the bulk of countries here are going to be in a region where their share of exports and imports invoiced in dollars is about 3 to 5 times larger than the actual amount of trade they do with the US. Okay, so that's the sense in which there is a displacement in terms of invoicing relative to the size of the trade that you're actually doing with the US. Now, if we look on the financial side, this is a graph that initially was put together by the ECB. I think Barry, in one of his papers, updated it. We updated it again, so it's like a meme. But it sort of summarizes a number of dimensions where you can see the importance of the dollar along when you look at financial transactions. So the first panel here on the left is looking at the use of the dollar in foreign exchange transactions. The latest report from the BIS just came out, their triennial survey came out a week ago. I just looked at the numbers, they haven't changed very much. The dollar is involved in about 44% of the overall foreign exchange transactions. What has changed a lot is how many of these transactions there are. We went from about $4 trillion a day to about $6.5 trillion a day. It's still about 44% in dollars. So it's really very, very dominant here. The euro is a distant second. If you're looking at additional debt issuance, it's the same thing. I'll come back to that in a little while, but the dollar debt issuances are vastly in excess of any other currency's debt issuance. If you look at banking activity, bank loans issued in dollar, cross-border banks, bank loans, again, tend to be in dollar first. Foreign exchange reserves held by central banks, this is likely to be an underestimate because this number, 62%, is based on the allocated reserves that countries are reporting to the IMF, but there are a number of countries that don't disclose the composition of their reserves. They are likely to hold dollars as well. So that's likely to be, and I suspect that many of them hold a lot of dollars, so that's likely to be even higher. And then finally, global payment currency. There, the euro is sort of a closer second, but still the dollar comes ahead. So you look at all these dimensions, trade, finance, and you find a very strong importance of the dollar. Now, what about how investors allocate their international portfolios? And here, there is a very interesting paper by Matteo Maggiore, Brent Neumann, and Jesse Schrager, just came out in the JPE, that uses mutual fund level data, Morningstar data, to look at the portfolio holdings of mutual fund investors across many different countries and looking at securities issued by many different issuers, either in local currency or in foreign currency. And what jumps at you when you look at this data is that basically foreign investors are not going to touch your bonds if they're issued in the local currency. So if you're a Canadian issuer and you issue in Canadian dollars, only Canadian investors will buy your assets. If you want to have assets that are going to be held by foreign investors, they're going to have to be in US dollars. And that's sort of what you see in this bars here. The red is the share of the local currency bond issued by issuers in a particular country held by the domestic investors. And the blue there is the share that is held by foreign investors. You see that the blue is very, very small, except for the US, because the US issues in dollars, of course, that's the domestic and the foreign currency for them. And therefore, they are able to tap a much bigger market right away. If we look at bank loans and digging a little bit deeper here, if we look at bank loans and international debt securities, you can see here that this is the red line here is showing you the fraction of global output that is represented by bank loans issued in dollars. The dash one is in euros. The short dashes here is in Japanese yen. You can see that for a while, issuances in euro, whether you're looking at bank loans or international debt, was going up. After 2008, it just comes back down, and the eurozone crisis sort of dealt a very serious blow there in terms of the market's willingness to issue in euro. And instead, we have very strong increase in issuance in dollars, with an increase in debt securities relative to bank loans as the banks were retrenching a little bit, especially in later years. But the currency didn't change. It's the instrument that changed. It went from bank loans to debt securities, but it was always dollars. Now, what about anchor currencies? So this is a graph that I took from the recent QJE paper by Ethan Nielsetsky, Carmen Reinhart, and Ken Rogoff that looks at the anchor currency. So the anchor is being defined as the currency to which against which you have the lowest volatility if you want any given point in time. So it does not mean that you're actually pegging your currency to the anchor. It means that you're sort of somehow, you know, not letting it float completely, or you're sort of looking at what's happening against that anchor currency. So this encompasses a variety of exchange rate arrangements that are going from fixing or adopting that foreign currency to various forms of dirty floating or managed floats, if you want. This picture here is as of 1950. So in the main era of the Bretton Woods system, and what you see in red are those regions of the world that are anchoring to the US dollar. Green is countries that are formally anchoring, according to Izetsky, Reinhardt, and Rogoff, to the British pound. And of course, there isn't really any euro there, so it's not represented. But you have, you know, the French franc, especially in some African countries. And you have the ruble here that is sort of the anchor currency for part of the Soviet bloc at the time. That represents about 30% of countries in the world, about 70% of economic activity at the time. Fast forward to 2015, and the red is sort of swept through. It now represents 70% of countries and still about 70% of economic activity. So the extent to which countries are in informal ways or formal ways anchoring to the dollar is actually very similar now in terms of economic activities, much bigger in terms of number of countries than it was in the 1950s. Okay, so a lot of these facts are now sort of being well known, and we start to have models that are looking at them. And so here I'm sort of going to just summarize a few of the arguments that are floating around in the literature. And these arguments emphasize that there are interactions between the different dimensions of a global currency. So there are linkages and the complementarities between being an invoicing currency and being an anchor currency, being an anchor currency and being a funding currency, or being a funding currency and a reserve currency. And so, for instance, in recent work, Dmitry Mukin and his co-author have written a paper that shows how if firms are actually invoicing in dollars, it generates the kind of asymmetric spillovers from monetary policy that makes it more desirable to anchor to the dollar for the monetary authorities. Okay? So you're more likely to anchor to the dollar if your exporters are pricing in dollars and your importers are also facing dollar prices. Conversely, if you are anchoring to the dollar, then the simple arguments on optimal invoicing will tell you that it's more likely that you will want to invoice in dollar. So that's another linkage here, and you see that this loop is going to be self-reinforcing. And that's actually also related to some work that Dmitry Mukin has done in his job market paper. There is a link between a funding currency and an anchor currency. So if dollar funding increases spillovers from U.S. monetary policy because of various kinds of mismatches on financial intermediaries' balance sheets, then that is going to create an incentive to maybe limit the fluctuations vis-a-vis the dollar. And that's an argument very much related to the previous paper we saw, or the global financial cycle that Hélène has been working on. You can go through this list. I'm not going to detail all of them, but there is a lot of interesting, very interesting theoretical work that leads us to think that these complementarities are there. They're important. We can actually think about ways of measuring how strong they are. And all of these things are going to create a lock-in effect in favor of whatever is the current global currency. So in the current situation, that would be the dollar. Now, as I said, at the same time, the current era started with a run on the dollar. So it certainly started with, you know, monetary authorities moving away from the dollar in the early 70s. And in the early 70s, the dollar depreciated significantly against most other currency. The one salient exception here is the sterling. Sterling actually declined even more than the dollar between, say, 71 and 75. Okay, so I want to argue here, I'm not going to present a proof, I want to argue that maybe we have a situation where sort of three different dynamics that are at play. One dynamic is the one that was identified by Robert Triffin in his original Triffin Dilemma that he was writing about in the 60s, basically points out that in a system where the U.S. is supposed to maintain the value of the dollar in terms of gold at $35 an ounce, but the demand for dollars is growing because the world economy is growing and the stock of gold is more or less constant, there will come a point when there will be more dollar reserves out there than there is stock of gold in the vaults of the Federal Reserve. And that's sort of a classic case for a run on the currency. And effectively, the system collapses first with a link between dollar and gold being severed in 1968, at least for private transactions, then later on for transactions between central banks. So that would be sort of the original Triffin dilemma, and I think that's sort of relatively well understood. Now, consequent to that, we had a period in which there was relatively more dollars floating around than central banks wanted to hold and investors wanted to hold. So the depreciation that happened then is also sort of sensible in that context. But I want to argue that what's going on and that maybe underpins the reemergence of the dollar is sort of a lower frequency dynamics. If you think of the center currency as the one that is providing also a reserve asset or a safe asset for the global economy, in a system like you had in the Bretton Woods system, where you had both fixed exchange rate but also very limited capital mobility, that meant that private demand for safe assets in foreign countries had to be met not by holding directly dollar assets, they couldn't directly get their hands on them because there were capital controls, but by holding local currency assets that in effect were backed by dollar through the fixed exchange rate system. Now, the underlying dynamics that goes through the 70s and the 80s and so on is the unraveling of capital flows in the global economy. So at that point, that means that those private investors who wants to be holding a safe asset can directly decide to relocate their demand towards the US. And we see some of that demand emerging in the 1970s. And at that point, that creates a support and sort of a level of support for the dollar as well. And so I want to argue that the demand for safe assets that was sort of growing in the world was initially met by foreign local currency assets that was sort of relocated back to the US after the collapse of Bretton Woods and the emergence of an era of capital mobility. It didn't happen over time. Actually, if you try to date it, I would say that probably by the early 80s is when it really starts to get into play. So Mundell may have been a little bit early in his statement, but you know, he didn't shy from making provocative statements every now and then. But certainly by the early 1980s, that was well on its way. Okay, and so that suggests that's going to be a theme I come back to, that there might be a modern form of the Triffin dilemma, not so much linked to the link between dollar and gold, but linked to the ability of the U.S. to provide a safe asset to the world economy when it's becoming a shrinking part of that global economy. Yeah, I'll come back to that. All right, now, to wit, here's a fun exercise I did. I took the country chronologies from the Izetsky, Reinhardt, and Rogoff paper in the QJE. That's the huge online appendix that has for each country what anchor currency they had over what period. Now, you may disagree with their algorithm for identifying the anchor currency, but I want to sort of highlight one interesting tidbit from that. So here, I have a table with a bunch of Asian countries. And for each of these Asian countries, what I put in the second column is the start of the dollar, the current dollar anchor that these countries are in, according to the Izetsky, Reinhardt, Rogoff chronologies. So for instance, the Philippines, in fact, already in 1945 were on the dollar anchor. Japan, July 1947, et cetera, et cetera. And then the last column lists what is the previous anchor if there was one. The algorithm doesn't necessarily assign one anchor if you were a currency that was either couldn't be traded or was collapsing completely, you wouldn't have an anchor at all. And what I want to emphasize is that a number, according to this chronology, a number of countries in Asian countries switched to the dollar exactly at the time when the Bretton Woods system collapsed, or within a short amount of time after that. So Pakistan, Singapore, Hong Kong, Malaysia, India, between 71 and 75. And all of these countries, I ranked them, by the way, I ranked them by the date of adoption of the dollar as an anchor. All of them were actually, again, according to this classification, anchoring to the sterling before that. Now, we can understand why they were anchoring to the sterling. There were historical and colonial ties for each of these countries that would make sense that they would be anchoring to the sterling. But you have to ask yourself, well, why does it mean to anchor to the sterling in an era where the sterling itself is anchoring to the dollar? Because remember, this is Bretton Woods, so the UK, the sterling, is itself anchoring to the dollar. And so what this is suggesting is that what they may have been doing is, in fact, have a shadow anchor to the dollar. But it didn't really matter at the time because sterling itself was anchoring to the dollar. So you didn't have to change anything. You were effectively already anchoring to what you wanted. But when the dollar-sterling exchange rate starts moving a lot, at that point you have to make a decision. And at that point, all these countries decide to switch to a dollar anchor. Now, why is this relevant? Because we could be witnessing something very similar when we think about the emergence of an RMB anchor. The RMB-dollar exchange rate moves, but it doesn't move that much. So effectively, a lot of countries that I just told you, 70% of economic activity, 70% of countries are anchoring to the dollar, maybe a lot of that is reflecting a shadow RMB anchor. Countries don't have to decide because the two of them are sort of moving more or less in lockstep. Not completely. I'm exaggerating a bit the argument. Okay? But if you were to witness a lot of volatility in the dollar RMB exchange rate, that's when a lot of countries, maybe the same countries you have on this table, would have to think about what they want to do in terms of their anchor currency. And it may be that at that point it would not be the dollar. Okay? So I just want to put it there. All right, implications for policymakers. So now I'm going to take all of these facts, you know, the Stiers fact I've just put there, and I'm going to sort of try to lay out five sort of implications for relevant implications for policymakers that are coming from recent research, in particular some of the work I've been doing with various people. A lot of this will build on my work with Gita Gopinath or my work with Ricardo Caballero and Emmanuel Fari or my work with Hélène. Right, so the first implication is in terms of exchange rate pass-through and the effectiveness of flexible exchange rates. So in a paper I have with Gita and four other co-authors, it's basically a huge paper that combines a lot of data coming from different sources, but one of the things we do is we say, well, in a world in which trade is invoiced in dollars, what we should expect to see is that it's the dollar exchange rate that is going to matter for pass-through and not so much the bilateral exchange rate. In other words, if you look at trade flows between Brazil and Japan, it's not the real yen exchange rate that is going to be important, it's the real dollar for Brazil and it's the yen dollar for Japan. And in fact, when we test that, so this is the first panel here, we look at import prices and we run some pass-through regression. These are import prices. This is coming from a database that has all bilateral trade prices and quantities, and the nominal exchange, the bilateral exchange rate seems to be coming through when it's alone, but once you put the dollar exchange rate, the exchange rate between the dollar and the destination, then that knocks off almost all of the economic effect in terms of pass-through. So the pass-through is really driven by how your currency is moving against the dollar, not so much how it's moving against your bilateral trade partners, and that could be very, very different. Very different implications. Another implication is that your exports, if they're invoiced in dollars, should not be responding too much to a depreciation of the local currency. They should be responding bilateral. They should be responding, and maybe with a lag, because the exports, the dollar price is not going to change, so the demand for your goods is not going to change, so you're not going to have much of an immediate response in terms of exports to a depreciation. You should find a response to it on the import side. But again, that response on the import side should be largely driven by what's happening to the dollar exchange rate. And that's by and large what we find when we look at the bilateral trade data between countries. We do the same exercise using microdata for Colombia, and we confirm that this is also holding at the firm level. And that's the first implication. So what does that mean? Well, it means that expenditure switching is going to be weak. Expenditure switching effects are going to be weak. Why? Well, because they're going to work through imports only, not so much through exports. They imply also that terms of trade are not going to be responding very much to what happens to your exchange rate. Your currency could depreciate or appreciate. If exports and imports are priced in dollars, the terms of trade, which is the ratio of the price of exports to imports, is not going to change either. For instance, there is another implication that we emphasize in that work, that the inflation output trade-off that you're going to face as a policymaker in a small open economy when trade invoicing is in dollars is going to be less attractive than in other forms of invoicing like producer currency pricing or local currency pricing. Why is that? Well, I just explained to you that exports are not going to respond very much. Imports are still going to respond, but exports are not going to respond very much. So what's going to happen if you look at an expansionary monetary policy is your output is not going to grow as much as under producer currency pricing. Producer currency pricing here is the black dashes. The solid line is what happens under dominant currency pricing, which means, in that case, dollar pricing. The other one is local currency pricing, when you price in the export destination currency. But the inflation effects are still going to be there. Why? Well, because the price of your imports has gone up. So you depreciate your currency, you don't get as much stimulus on the export side, but you get the full inflation impact. So the trade-off in terms of how effective your stimulus is going to be and how much of a cost you're going to face is going to be less attractive for a policymaker. A second implication that we emphasize, and here I want to be clear that this is not necessarily the only mechanism that could give us something like that, is that there's going to be a link between the dollar, the value of the dollar against other currencies, and global trade. Okay? And the argument is the following. If the dollar appreciates against all other currencies, again, that means that for every other country in the world, their exports, their imports are going to be more expensive, so they're just going to start cutting down on imports, and that's going to reduce everyone's imports and someone else's exports. That's going to reduce global trade. So global trade is going to be smaller if the in periods in which the dollar appreciates. Now, we estimate the strength of that effect by taking our trade elasticity regression, the one I showed you here, and from the disaggregated level, and then re-aggregating them up by weighting by trade weights. And what we find is that a 1% appreciation of the dollar is associated with between 0.6 and 0.8% decline in the volume of trade between countries in the rest of the world within a year. So that's a pretty sizable effect. I want to emphasize that this is not the only channel through which a strong dollar could reduce global trade. You could think of financial frictions, you could think of other channels, but the one we're estimating here is certainly consistent with what an environment in which you have dollar pricing would imply. There's a question. No. Okay, so third implication for policymakers is related to the dilemma debate that Hélène has been writing about. We know that the dollar is involved in financial transactions. Financial intermediaries have dollar liabilities on their balance sheet. That creates a sensitivity to the dollar and therefore indirectly to US monetary policy. And so that's a channel of transmission that can go from US monetary policy to balance sheet of financial intermediaries to economic activity in other countries. It could be through the dollar, it could be because, as Shebnem Kalemlioskan or Ben Bernanke have argued, it could be because risk premia also change or risk appetite in the, of global financial intermediaries changes in relation to maybe what happens in the US. So there are various channels of transmission here. One implication of this is that it might make controlling or leaning against the wind when you're thinking about the movements of your currency against the dollar more desirable. Okay, and that's the sense in which you might have somewhat of a dilemma here. In some work I've done recently, I look at this question with a fairly simple model where I introduce financial frictions that are amplified by movements in a dollar exchange rate. So I write down a small open economy model where you have a financial friction, and the strength of this financial friction tightens or becomes stronger when the dollar appreciates, or conversely, when the local currency depreciates. So you see that this is going to go against sort of the standard Mundell-Fleming type of arguments that the depreciation is expansionary, because now the depreciation is also going to tighten your financial constraints. Now the point I make in this paper is that the implications for optimal monetary policy depend critically on the strength of the financial friction. If the financial friction is very weak, well, we are in the Mundell-Fleming type world, and we shouldn't expect results to be very different. So flexible exchange rates remain desirable, and they have the usual insulating properties that we teach our students in the first year of their PhD program. If the balance sheet effects through the exchange rate have an intermediate strength, then you could have a situation where, as the US tightens and the dollar appreciates, that transmits a negative impulse into the domestic economy, so the domestic economy also tilts over into a recession. Okay, the US tightening is now contractionary abroad, but it remains the case that domestic easing is expansionary, and though what that means is that cutting interest rates and letting your exchange rate depreciate is what you should be doing. So in fact, flexible exchange rates are even more desirable, despite the fact that you have this adverse transmission of monetary policy at the center. There is, however, a third case in which the balance sheet effects become really strong. In that case, they are so strong that really what you want to do is you want to maintain the value of your currency against the dollar, because doing that will limit the adverse effect of this of these balance sheet effects. So that would be a situation where you'd want to move or, you know, anchor to the dollar. Maybe not go all the way to fixing, but you'd certainly want to anchor to the dollar. And you recover, in a simple theoretical exercise, you recover exactly these three cases. So here in this figure, the top row here is showing you the response of the local economy to a US monetary policy tightening under three different configurations for the strength of the financial frictions, weak, intermediate, and high. The bottom row is showing you the response of the same local economy, but now to a local monetary policy tightening under the same three configuration, weak, intermediate, and high. So the first, if I look in columns now, in column space, the first column is showing you the response in a Mundell-Fleming environment. So if there is a tightening abroad, if there is a tightening abroad, that's the top one. If there is a tightening abroad, it's expansionary in the local economy because of expenditure switching effects. If there is a tightening at home, it's contractionary. So in that environment, you would want to use or let the exchange rate sort of flow to adjust and absorb what's happening abroad. In the intermediate case, now observe that a US monetary policy tightening becomes contractionary in the local economy. That's because these financial frictions are sufficiently strong that they're enough to tip over the local economy into a recession. But it remains the case that if you ease monetary policy, it's going to be expansionary as well at home. So the optimal response here is to actually to have even more of an exchange rate response. You certainly don't want to fix the exchange rate. But there is this third case here, and this third case is the case of high spillovers. Now the US monetary policy is still having a negative effect, but now home monetary policy is also having the opposite effect of the one intended. So if I were to tighten monetary policy, because it helps to appreciate the currency, it's actually expansionary locally. That is the case where you might have room for reducing fluctuations in your currency. But observe that this is a particularly perverse case of transmission of monetary policy. It says that monetary policy transmits with the wrong sign. When I tighten monetary policy, it's expansionary. Now, maybe this is how it works in a number of countries, but I think this is more of an empirical proposition. Tommaso. No, they're just shutting down the U.S. shock. This, think of this as an impulse response. But it's combining the two. It tells you how you would want to respond to what the U.S. economy is doing to your economy. Okay. So then the fourth implication is one I alluded to in terms of the scarcity of safe assets. So here I'm going to make a statement that I strongly believe in, but I think there is room for discussion and room for maybe disagreement, which is that we have some evidence, convincing in my view, that we live in an environment in which global safe assets are scarce. Exhibit A for this, in my view, is the low real risk-free rates in advanced economies. Exhibit B, which suggests that this is really about safety and not so much about an increase in saving, is the fact that there is a lot of evidence that a number of risk premia are currently at elevated levels, not at low levels, once you adjust for the fact that interest rates are incredibly low. So things like price earnings ratio are not as high as they would be given how low interest rates are. Corporate bond spreads are not as low as you'd expect them to be given the low level of leverage and the low level of volatility in the bond markets. And estimates of equity risk premia are also fairly elevated as measured by standard metrics. So I'm going to take that as a sort of a characteristic of the environment. That could reflect the fact that, by and large, the supply of the safe assets locates itself right now largely on the US and very few other providers. Okay? And this has three main implications. The first implication is that the lack of supply of the safe assets, which comes from the fact that the US economy is only so big in relation to the world economy, maintains the global environment on the edge of a safety or liquidity trap. Okay, so it reduces the space that we have with monetary policy for trying to sort of maintain the global economy at full employment. And you know, the last 10 years are certainly not giving me any sense that somehow that assessment is incorrect. The second point is that this creates an environment in which there are very important spillovers from policies that don't usually play a big role in normal times. Things like currency wars or things like trade wars, imposing tariffs on another country's goods or trying to depreciate your currency vis-a-vis your trading partners in an environment where you are close to a liquidity trap is a way to shift the burden of adjustment onto the rest of the world. These policies play almost no role when we're outside of liquidity trap environments, because then standard policies can keep you close to full employment. And so there's very little room for them to improve welfare in a meaningful way. But once we are stuck in these kinds of safety or liquidity trap, they play a very important role. Again, my own reading would be that the emphasis on either trying to move exchange rates around or recent discussions about trade policy are certainly consistent with that particular reading of events. And the third one is that policies that are optimal locally can be destabilizing globally. Accumulating reserves, fiscal austerity, because you view the environment as being very uncertain and therefore you want to keep your powder dry, and things like that can increase the demand for safe assets, reduce the supply of those same safe assets, and so exacerbate the problem at a global level. And there's very interesting work by Luca Fornaro and Federica Romei that sort of emphasizes this point. So I think that, again, is sort of a consequence of the hegemonic role of the dollar in its reserve currency or safe asset currency dimension in an environment in which it's the only game in town. Okay? And a way to illustrate that this problem is not likely to go away is to look at either past or predicted evolutions of output shares in the world economy. And so here's a graph that just lifted from the World Economic Outlook, shows you the share of US GDP in world GDP since 1980. The blue shaded area over there is the projections that the World Economic Outlook, the staff at the IMF is making. Take those with a grain of salt. But the trends, I think, are largely not a matter of disagreement. And we see a decline in the share of the US that is likely to continue. We see a rise in emerging markets. We see a decline in Europe. And so the question of being in an environment in which the only at scale safe asset is being provided by the US, where the scale of the US is shrinking, is what Hélène Rey and Emmanuel Fari and I called sort of the new version of the Triffin dilemma. In other words, an environment in which it exacerbates the pressure on safe interest rates. It exacerbates the likelihood that the economy, the global economy, could be stuck in these environments and creates all kinds of volatile consequences. All right, so one last thing that I want to mention briefly is work I've done with Hélène Rey and Nicolas Govillot that looks at this supply of safe assets by the US and demand for safe assets issued by the US from the rest of the world from the perspective of a risk-sharing agreement between the rest of the world and the US. And so this, if you want, this would be sort of the benign interpretation of what we are seeing in terms of the external position of the US vis-a-vis the rest of the world, is that it represents some form of risk-sharing that is being implemented at the global level. And we want to push this argument to its logical limit and see, you know, how much we can make sense of what we see under that scenario. And so in order to do that, what we're really trying to do is build a model that will be able to explain three facts. And the three facts are the following. First, we have evidence that as a consequence of the fact that it issues a safe asset, therefore that an asset has a low return, and on the other side of its balance sheet, it's holding risky asset, the US is collecting something that is akin to a risk premia. And it's collecting risk premia that generates an excess return on its net foreign asset position. There are various estimates of how big this excess return could be. It depends how you measure it. There are all kinds of problems with the data in terms of measuring it very precisely. It's somewhere between 1% a year and 3% a year. Okay. It suffers, fact number two, it suffers outsized losses during times of crisis. How do we know this? Well, we had an episode of global financial crisis in 2008. What do we see when we look at the external balance sheet of the US in 2008? Well, we see a large decline in the assets that it has against the rest of the world. And if anything, the liabilities went up. The liabilities went up because the dollar held its value and the US treasuries, which is a big liability of the US, also experienced capital gains. Capital gains, therefore, that would be transferred to the foreigners. How big? Our estimates, we did some work with the lending, measuring the size of this, about 14% of US GDP during the time of the crisis. So a sizable transfer to the rest of the world at a time when the marginal utility of resources is high, because that's the definition of a crisis. And the third fact, which will turn out to be the one that is hardest to fit in this kind of explanation, is the fact that the dollar appreciated or appreciates in general in times of crisis. Okay? Now, we sort of think that this is somehow intuitive, that the dollar would appreciate in times of crisis, but it turns out that generating that particular fact is not trivial. Now, fact one and two are consistent with a simple risk-sharing model. If I'm telling you either the US has something very special that's called a safe asset it can sell to the rest of the world, or if I tell you somehow the US is a financial system that allows it to experience, to have more tolerance for risk than the rest of the world, then you can imagine that the optimal trade will be for the US to load up on risk and for the rest of the world to shed risk vis-a-vis the US. And so that's going to give you an excess return in good times. That's going to give you losses in bad times. That's very, very easy to do. The third fact is harder to do, because in any insurance arrangement, you would expect that in those times when the US is making a payment, then those are times when the price of US goods would tend to be low and not to be high. And therefore, these models would generically give you a depreciation of the dollar in times of crisis, not an appreciation. So something else is needed for this third fact, but our take here is going to be that there is one possible interpretation of what's going on, which is that these times of crisis are also times when the demand for insurance is rising a lot. Let me rephrase, we're going to call these risk-off episodes. We're going to say that when there are times of crisis, then risk appetite in the financial system is going to decline, and therefore the demand for insurance is going to rise. So these are sort of the three facts we want to match, and we're going to do it with a combination of risk-sharing model and this risk-off dynamics. And we're going to ask, well, how well can we account for what we observe empirically, so the size of this excess return, the size of the valuation losses, the size of the appreciation of the dollar in crisis times. So let me actually just skip those slides here and just basically get directly to the empirical results. So what we do is we take a simple model in which there are shocks. Some of these shocks can be pretty bad. It's a model with disaster risk. And then sometimes the world becomes riskier. We get closer to experiencing a disaster. And in those times when the world is becoming riskier, you also have this risk-off episode. People really want to load up on insurance. So we have these two things. We're going to ask the model to match a bunch of moments. We're going to ask the model to match some probabilities and conditional probabilities about crisis that we can get from, you know, the work of people who worked on disaster risk, like Barrow and a list of co-authors. We're going to ask to match risk premia. We're going to ask to match the trade balance of the U.S. We're going to ask to match some business cycle volatility variables. And then we're going to want to match the appreciation of the dollar, which in the data is around 8% in the last episode in 2008. So this data here are the moments we feed into the model. The estimated ones are the ones we get out as we estimate the model. The last two ones here on the last row are unmatched moments. This is the excess return on the net foreign asset position, which I told you is between 1 and 3. We're going to take a number in between. That's going to be 2%. And this is the valuation loss here of the US in times of crisis. Told you it's about 14%. These two moments, we don't give the model. We're not asking the model to match them. But we're going to see how well the model is doing. And the answer is the model is doing very well. We're matching about 8% of the appreciation. We're generating about 1.7% excess return. We're generating about 12% valuation loss. Remember, these last two were never told, the model never knew about them. Okay? How does the model do it? Well, I remember I told you that we have two things. We have this probability of disaster, and then we have this risk off, risk on dynamics. So here, I'm showing you, this is the risk aversion that we find for the US in normal times, in safe times. This is a risk aversion for the rest of the world in safe times. The model tells us they're not different, about 2.7. Then we move to this fragile time when the risk of a disaster is more likely to happen. And the model tells us, well, nothing happens in the US. It stays at 2.7, but it jumps to 5.7 in the rest of the world. That jump here, this risk-off behavior that jumps to 5.7, is enough to basically get us all three facts. It gets us the excess return, gets us the valuation loss, and it gets us the appreciation of the real exchange rates. We also estimate some of the probabilities of a transition from safe to fragile, fragile to disaster, etc. And again, they're sort of appropriately low. It's not that we're telling you a story about disasters happening with very high probability. Now, this is a bit of an extreme exercise. It's not that we believe the world is characterizing sort of an optimal risk-sharing arrangement, is well characterized by an optimal risk-sharing arrangement between the US and the rest of the world. And if that were the case, I would have to tell you a little bit more about where that risk-off behavior is coming from, which I'm not. I'm sort of taking it as given here. But I want to hint, this is the direction where you sort of want to put a lot more effort in understanding what's going on, because that model is actually accounting for a good deal of the aggregate variables and orders of magnitude. So something like that must be part of the story. It doesn't say that the frictions and the balance sheets and financial cycles are not playing a role, but they are probably playing a role through that increase in this risk aversion in fragile times. Okay. All right, implications for the future, and I'm almost out of time. I want to make sure that leave time for questions. I'm just taking stock a little bit. The first one is, because of all these interlocking effects we described and the dominance of the dollar, I think the, you know, when we're thinking about speculating about what might happen to that standard, it's here to stay. My own prediction would be that we're not going to see any dramatic change in years to come. It's dysfunctional. It's pushing the global economy close to the safe asset trap, but there is just no alternative to this environment, and so we have to sort of think about how to handle the spillovers, how to handle the coordination that is needed in an environment like this. The second observation is that in the very long run, because of the consequences of this new Triffin dilemma that I showed you, it's also clear that the dollar dominance is bound to disappear, whether it's going to transition to a multilateral, multipolar world or be replaced entirely. I think it's anyone's guess at this point. But eventually, the US will just become too small and will be too distortive to just rely on the US only. And so there will be incentives, whether at the state level or at the private level, to increase the supply of safe assets. And that will become eventually alternatives to the US dollar. That environment is fraught with dangers as well. The transition could be complicated. A multipolar world could be complicated. It doesn't necessarily have to be, but could be complicated. And the third point, I want to go back to this table I showed you with the transition from the sterling to the dollar. I want to sort of, maybe point out that the transition, when it happens, which I view as something that is in the distant future, but could be quite sudden. And again, the argument I'm making here is that we may already have something like a shadow RMB anchor that doesn't need to express itself by formally anchoring to the RMB, and that could actually emerge very quickly once monetary instability between these two regions emerges, and if it emerges. I'll stop here.